God of the universe, look thou with favor upon these here assembled, and bestow thy guidance upon the members of the governing body in their deliberations. This we ask in thy name. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Isn't she wonderful? Isn't she?
It was our mom.
Oh, okay. It's funny, I was raised without a cell phone, and we didn't need it, we didn't use it, and it seems like everybody must have one on their hands, or your whole life falls apart. So please turn them off, let's be respectful. Mr. Clerk, please call the roll.
Mrs. Ormond?
Here.
Javik?
Here.
Brown?
Here.
Brooks?
Here.
Cosby-Hurling?
Present.
Sadowski?
Here.
Strano?
Here.
Yamakaitis?
Here.
Medina?
Here.
Hickey?
Here.
Mr. Alvarez?
Right here. We're going to start by approving the minutes of January 17, 2017 of the regular meeting. I need a motion.
Yes, Council President. I make a motion for the approval of the regular meeting January 17, 2017 and ask for a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Cosby-Hurling?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Hickey?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
I will abstain since I was not here. I was in Hawaii getting a nice tan. It was beautiful, 80 degrees every day. Okay, let's start with ordinances on hearing. This is the date and time established for the public hearing for ordinances on hearing. Mr. Boda, can you please read 61-2?
An ordinance to amend and supplement Chapter 7, Traffic, amending Chapter 7, Traffic 7-33, Handicap Parking Regulations, 7-33.1A, Handicap Parking on Street. Name of street, delete 36 10th Street, one space, and 1400 Eddy Avenue, one space.
Has any written communication been received?
No, sir.
Has the ordinance been properly published and posted?
Yes, sir.
Is there anyone that wants to speak on this ordinance? In that case, may I have a motion, please?
Yes, Mr. Council President. I move that the hearing for ordinance number 61-2 be closed, the ordinance adopted, and I request a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Cosby-Hurling?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Hickey?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Mr. Boda, can you please read 61-3?
An ordinance repealing ordinance number 60-76 entitled An Ordinance to Amend and Supplement Chapter 7, Traffic of an Ordinance Adopting and Enacting the Revised General Ordinances of the City of Linden, 1999, passed November 23, 1999, and approved November 24, 1999, and as amended and supplemented.
Has the ordinance been properly published and posted?
Yes, sir.
Has any written communication been received?
No, sir.
Is there anyone that would like to speak on this particular ordinance? May I have a motion, please?
Council President, I move that the hearing be closed and ordinance 61-3 be adopted and request a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Cosby-Hurling?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Hickey?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Mr. Boda, can you please read 61-4?
An ordinance to amend an ordinance entitled An Ordinance Establishing a Schedule of Titles, Salary Ranges, and Regulations for Maintaining the Classification and Salary Standardization Plan of All Employees of the City of Linden, passed August 15, 1995, and approved August 16, 1995, amending and modifying Schedule 4-LL-1.
Has the ordinance been properly published and posted?
Yes, sir.
Has any communication been received?
No, sir.
Does anybody want to speak on this particular ordinance? May I have a motion, please?
I move the hearing is closed and ordinance 61-4 is adopted and ask for a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Cosby Hurley?
No.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yemekaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Hickey?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. This is time for our consent agenda. All items listed with asterisks are considered to be routine by the City Council and will be enacted with one motion. There will be no separate discussion on these items unless a council member or citizen so requests, in which event the item will be removed from the general order of business and considered in its normal sequence on the agenda, items 1 through 5. Does anybody wish to remove any of these points? At this time, can I have a motion, please?
Mr. Council President, I'd like to move items 1 through 5 and ask for a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Cosby Hurley?
Abstain.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yemekaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Hickey?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. At this time, we're going to move into the chairman's and the council's comments. Let's get started with Councilwoman Lisa Ormond, please.
Thank you, Council President. I'd just like to start off by saying how important all facets of our government working together, how important it really is. Many of you know that last month there was a lockdown at Linden High School. A 16-year-old was threatening to inflict harm on her fellow students. And it just goes to show that leadership and working together will always be a win-win for all. We had our Linden Police Department, our Board of Education, and the city collectively working together to make sure that the person that created such havoc and chaos in our school district was apprehended. So I would like to just personally thank Dr. Robitozzi, Mrs. Jelena Horry, who's the principal, Chief Parham and his wonderful police officers, and our mayor, Derek Armstead, for working together to ensure that our city is safe. I also would like to express my sincere thanks to DPW for their job during our snowstorm. Nothing is ever perfect, but you guys did a wonderful job, and you did better than the previous snowstorms. And that's all that we can ask, is that each time you get better and better. Sometimes you're going to have those same residents that are just not happy and feel as though we are patting you on the back for just doing your job. But sometimes we need to tell you, job well done, and thank you for your efforts. People don't realize that you leave your families, you don't shovel your walkways or your driveways while you're out there plowing the snow to make sure that the residents of Linden have safe passage. So I personally want to say thank you for a job well done. And I would also like to thank the residents of the First Ward who followed the street parking ordinance. There was no parking on one side of the street on Thursday, so it enabled a lot of the plows to be able to get through and do a much better job on the streets as if we had parking on both sides. I also would like to take the time to compliment the fire department, because we've had several fires in our city, and particularly we had one in the First Ward. Chief Dooley and the Linden Police Department did a great job at making sure that the fire was put out with little damage or no damage to other houses or areas around. So we'd like to thank them. It's a very, very difficult job, and they definitely need to be acknowledged for their hard work and their dangerous work. The Tree Shade Commission will be out in the First Ward. If you had a tree cut down and your tree was completely stumped correctly, and we feel as though we can plant a tree back in that place, the Tree Shade Commission will be doing so. If there are empty areas that you would like to have a tree planted, please reach out to me. I will make sure that the commission knows that you're in need of a tree. And if you have not been properly stumped, which means, like I said, ground down to a fine pulp, please let me know so we can make sure that someone gets out there to handle that for you. I would also like to let the residents of the First Ward know that we're going to try to get together sometime in March for a meet and greet with the First, Second, and Third Ward. It's tentative at this point. Please check Channel 36 or 42 for details, because that's where we'll be posting it, as well as reaching out to the constituents in the area if we are able to secure a time. But we would like for the people in our communities to reach out and get to know one another. Also, we will be having our annual Easter egg hunt in April. I know it's a little bit early, but the best thing to do to make sure that all the children are invited and that the children will have an opportunity to participate is to get the information out early enough. Due to the large number of children that we are anticipating on having, we're probably going to have to do it in two sessions. The park, the time, and everything that pertains to the Easter egg hunt will be made known to you via, once again, our public access station. And we would also plan to utilize the school district with making sure that flyers go out via backpacks with all of the children so they can participate. Last year's event was wonderful. We had a lot of children, and we just like to continue with that. And I would just also like to take a few moments to just mention, I'm going to call him an unsung hero. Sometimes people do something behind the scenes, and we just never know what they're doing. But Linden has a special population of special needs children that, yeah, we know they're there, but there aren't a lot of activities for our special needs children that the city sponsors. So I would like to personally thank Al McDonald, who took the opportunity to sponsor or help our special needs children with a bowling tournament. Our Linden children were able to participate in the Special Olympics Region 5 tournament last month. And three of our children from Linden actually placed or medaled gold, silver, and bronze, and are now advancing to the semifinals, which will be held in Mattawan. Just knowing that Mr. McDonald cared enough without, you know, waving the flag of what he was doing really meant a lot to me. Yes, my children are special needs children, and my children participate in that particular activity. But it's something that I would like for all the parents in Linden to know, that we have a bowling league that is specially for the children with special needs. It is non-competitive. It meets every Saturday at Linden Lanes. And once again, it's non-competitive. You just bowl, you have a great time. It's an opportunity for parents to share and for us to really get together and understand that when our children are not behaving the way other children do, we understand each other. So once again, just a special thank you to Mr. McDonald for all of his support to our children. And that ends my report.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Councilman Javik.
Yes, thank you. Well, first of all, a big special thank you to our DPW and Frank Marcucci. Excellent snow removal, the best we've ever had in that area, okay? And a great snowstorm to handle it. Thank you to the Second Ward residents for your patience and for all that you did to move your cars off for plowing. We appreciate that. I would like to also acknowledge the Linden Police Department and Chief Dooley and everyone involved with for their outstanding job in putting out the fire on the United Lacquer. That was a Thursday night. It was real cold out there, and everybody was out, and they stayed there till early hours of the morning. It was running really good with everybody there. That was the one on Elizabeth Avenue, Second Ward. We sometimes forget how dangerous these situations are and how different their job is. Once again, thank you, and a job well done. Second Ward is not fully on the automated garbage collection schedule yet. We are in the process of purchasing new trucks with the hopes of having our ward and the entire city automated by the end of this year. So just bear with us, please. Our priority this year is going to focus on accountability and making sure the jobs get called in and prioritized and completed for the DPW. We will be using a new system called Dude Solutions that will allow jobs to be entered with complete follow-up until it is completed. We will also be able to monitor our trucks on the road via a new GPS tracking program. The good thing about this is if a house or street is missed for sanitation or recycle pickup, our system can verify if the truck went down your street and we can tell exactly what time it was. This will also allow us to deploy the trucks back to your area. As mentioned by Councilwoman Ormond, we will be hosting a meet and greet for wards 1, 2, and 3 at the JTG Center probably the end of March. Daytime and details will be on TV 36, channel 42, City website? Thank you. Okay. Daytime and details will follow. Okay, in April, our wards will host our Easter egg hunt for the children also. We're going to put out the information through the children at the schools, and we'll be also on cable station channel 36 and our website.
And our website.
And our website. And also Verizon 42. Anything else? To contact me with any concerns, please call 908-494-4608. Please leave a message if I don't pick up right away, or email me at bjavik@linden-newjersey.org. Thanks. That completes my report. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman Javik. Councilman Brown?
No report.
Thank you, Councilman. Councilman Brooks, before you start, sir, let me remind you, take your time, say everything you have to say.
Thank you, Councilman. I'd also like, you know, to piggyback on some of the things that would have already been said with regard to the lockdown at the high school. And, you know, some of you may have had children involved in that. I understand exactly how an parent would feel with regard to not knowing what's going on. But on the other side of that, being an individual who works for the Linden Board of Education, I was locked down. So I understand the difficulty that all parents had. I understand how they would feel. I understand, you know, having two sons of my own and sitting with children of parents and how stressful that is for them and how stressful it is for those parents who are waiting outside trying to figure out exactly what has happened. So again, I also give great credit to our police department, mayor, and everybody else who was involved with regard to making that situation as comfortable as possible in a most very tenuous situation. So again, thank you. Coming from a guy who was locked in, so I greatly appreciate it. Also, sun is out, warm weather, I'm starting to see everybody out. It's a good feeling. It's a good feeling to walk through the ward, you know, to have people out, to see people start to come out, almost like out of hibernation and saying hi and speaking to you, you know, and getting on your case a little bit because they had a little bit of time to think about it. But it's always good to see everybody out there. And everybody in the fourth ward, please keep in mind that I never forget that I operate at the behest of you, not the other way around. So when I see you out there, please continue to speak to me, continue to come up to me, continue to talk to me. It's always good to talk to you, and give me a call. The number, as I always say, is 908-406-8537. You need not do anything other than call me, text me. Councilwoman Ormond talked, I believe, last meeting with regard to how quickly she gets back in touch with everyone. I pride myself on the same thing. If I get a call from you or a text from you, you will get an answer from me almost immediately. Almost immediately, in the event that something has happened, as it does with everyone, 24 hours at tops. But I love to hear from you. I'm going to respond to you. Continue to do so. With regard to what's happening in the ward, so we want to keep an eye on some of the things that I have a lot of pride in. And one of those things is the tutorial program that is now being offered at the Linden Multipurpose Center. That tutorial program is for students who attend the Linden Multipurpose Center. That's the fourth to fifth and the eighth ward. But again, that's for everybody. Anybody who comes in and needs to be tutored has the ability to do so. Those tutors, this is what I'm most proud of, the tutors that are providing this service to the students are our own IB students. That's International Baccalaureate students who are involved at Linden High School. So our students are tutoring our students. And as per the information that I got from the Linden Multipurpose Center, Mr. Rooks Crawford, who's involved with that, the IB students are doing a fantastic job. So I'd like to thank the Board of Education, Linden Board of Education, Dr. Robert Tozzi, the superintendent, and also Mrs. Bernadette Patino, who is a supervisor for the IB students. They're doing a great job over there, and they're from the fourth, the fifth, and the eighth ward. So those students who are being the tutors, the IB students are coming from our fourth, fifth, and eighth wards tutoring our students. That's a great job. Also, this Saturday, I'll be having a financial aid workshop. It's one of those comments that says, you know, the more you bring to the marketplace, the more valuable you are. So I'm not just your councilman, I'm also the liaison who handles all financial aid at Linden High School. I work in conjunction with the guidance department. So I will be at Emmanuel Tabernacle Church this Saturday, the 25th, from 10 to 12. 2-hour time slot, 10 to 12. I'll be going over all financial aid. That's grants, not loans. So the basic difference is grants are free. You don't have to pay them back. Loans you do. So I'm looking at grants that are available to students, that's seniors, that's also parents, that's also recent graduates who may not have gone back to school but are now looking to go to school. That is not just the four-year colleges. That is also the community college. That's also vocational schools. That's also some trade schools. They must be fully accredited by the state of New Jersey. But again, feel free to come over. That's Emmanuel Tabernacle Church this Saturday, 10 to 12. Feel free to come over. I provide all documents that are required. There is no cost to you. Come over, say hi to me. Let's sit down and talk. If you're interested in a school or a trade school, come on by. More than happy to talk with you. The appointment that I had with First Baptist Church as a result last month of the storm was canceled. So that's going to be rescheduled. I will let you know when that's going to be. So I will still be at First Baptist Church. I've already got approval to do that. It was delayed only because of the storm that we had and is going to be rescheduled. I will certainly let you know when that rescheduling is going to be. So again, this Saturday, to Emmanuel Tabernacle Church on Bower Street from 10 to 12. Please come out and talk to me, especially if you're interested in grants for college and or trade schools and or vocational schools. With regard to the Linden Multipurpose Center, we were talking about some of the repairs that are being done over there. Again, you know, some of the positive things that I like to talk about, not only at the Linden Multipurpose Center, but also at the Gregorio Center. The equipment with regard to exercise rooms have all been replaced. It's all new. Thanks again to Al McDonald getting all that information done, the bidding information out. All of those repairs are done. New equipment is already there. We also have patches for right now at the Linden Multipurpose Center to prevent some of the water that is seeping into the building. That's been patched, but the full roof is going to be redone. And again, that's at a substantial reduction, almost less than half of what was initially set out. And again, that's thanks to Mr. McDonald for being able to pull that off. So again, keep an eye open for that. Dr. King Park, always fourth ward to me, but Dr. King Park, for those old school guys that are out there, you know that is fourth ward park. It'll always be fourth ward. Part of my campaign, my platform, was to make sure that we got something done in terms of renovations at Dr. King Park. Those renovations are currently going on. If you go by Dr. King Park now, you'll see new stanchions. The backboards are not up yet, but so that everybody understands exactly what's going to be done, the entrances, both entrances, the entrance on the Bower Street side and the entrance on McCandless Street side, are going to be repaved. The path through the park is also going to be repaved. The basketball courts are going to be done. The area, if you're looking at the building from the at the park from the McCandless Street side, down the far end where our children play, that's going to be renovated. To the left of that, on the other end, is a workout station. That's going to be renovated. So those renovations, if you ride by the park now, you will see them. Hopefully the weather continues to stay well, and we'll continue to start, and hopefully we'll get that thing done as quickly as possible. My conversations probably were looking at March, you know, provided the weather continues to stay as is, March doesn't come in like a line, we'll continue to go. And those renovations are being done. Again, already started, weather continues, we'll continue to go. With regard to some of the minutia, some of those things that I now have to do, I'm hereby, this is from our Department of Public Property. I hereby submit the monthly financial report for the Division of Transportation and Parking for the month of January 2017. This report includes the collection of on and off street parking meters, railroad parking lots, railroad parking permits, and merchant parking permits. New York side collection, $3,149. Trenton side collection, $3,277. Credit card transactions, $24,329.96. Parking meter collections, $9,480.68. Railroad permits, $13,710. Merchant parking permits, $6,848, with a grand total of $60,794.64. Coming from our city clerk's department, the following license, permits, transcripts issued in the city clerk's office during the month of January 2017 and fees received have been turned over to the municipal treasurer of the city of Linden. 113 birth, death, and marriage transcripts, $1,695. 17 marriage, civil union licenses, $51. State revenue, $425. Domestic partnership, none. Six malicious revenue, $40.80. Bingo raffles, none. Bureau of Vital Statistics, $2,865. State revenue, none. Burial permits, none, $25 state revenue. Interest earned, 80 cents for a grand total of $4,652.60. The City Clerk License Division is submitting this monthly report for the month of January 2017. This office issued 15 dog licenses and 48 malicious miscellaneous licenses and collected $6,390. Again, to contact me, 908-406-8537. Looking forward to hearing from you. That concludes my report, Council President.
Thank you, Councilman Brooks. I'm going to wait about a minute until you ask me you forgot something. Councilwoman Cosby Herling, you ready for us?
Sure, you ready for me? The Construction Code Committee report is on file in the clerk's office, and I'd like to request that a light for security be added to a public property located at pole number 60464. It's public property. It's near a bar restaurant, and the neighbors are concerned. They find sleeping drunk people, and they find litter and drug paraphernalia. So because it is public property, the area was visited, and I'm recommending that a light be installed to this location, similar to the ones that we have in the parks and playgrounds. And I'd like 4 seconds to that. Yeah, just to, you know, the polls that we put the list up.
Yeah. All right.
It's not scripted, so anybody can second it.
I'll second it.
Thank you. It's poll number 60464. Whenever there's a request for a light, we put the poll number. It goes to the clerk's office. Engineering works with public service. So long as that it's a valid situation. Okay. It's poll number 60464. It's located, the closest address is 2050 St. George's Avenue. It was seconded. So if we can get the light.
Yep. Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Cosby Herling?
Yes, please.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Hickey?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes.
Thank you. I attended the health department's meeting, and the members were sworn back in. Mrs. Lukenda is the president. There's no new initiatives happening at this point, but the health department has their meeting scheduled, and the next meeting is not going to be held until March. They did have last month a healthy heart demonstration, which was very important because it's Women's Heart Health Month, and they did an activity at the Gregorio Center to educate folks about heart health, and they had some interactive information, so that was nice. I'm also the liaison to the Sewage Authority, and I attended the first meeting. Unfortunately, I didn't allow enough time for myself to stay for the entire meeting, but I do want to report that the director intends to retire, so Roselle will be required to make an appointment when the president, I think he's the president commissioner, when he retires, that's a Roselle's appointment. There was a promotion also. Mr. Guerrero was promoted. It's a 12-month provisional promotion for him, so they're going to have an opportunity, they've probably posted it by now, for a hire, and that's a separate entity, and I'm not really familiar yet with how they do their public postings for employment, but it's the Linden Roselle Sewage Authority if anyone's interested to get that information. I am the liaison also to the Linden Housing Authority, and I did not attend the January meeting, so I will be making the next meeting, but I would like to send a get well wish to the director, Ms. Ferguson. She had been ill, so we're wishing her a speedy recovery. The liaison for the Board of Education, they meet tomorrow. I'm a co-liaison for that. I just wanted to thank them in advance for considering owning the Hooked on Fishing, Not on Drugs program that I started last year in the city. You can bring initiatives to the city, and unfortunately, there was very little interest in the Recreation Department in owning that program, but the Board of Education had five people actually volunteer to run the program for the children of Linden, so that was very good news. The children are excited, and I know that with the Board of Education support, we can do a lot more than we did last year, because the children will now have transportation and they can get to other activities throughout the county and the state, and it's a state-sponsored program, so that's something to look forward to, and hopefully tomorrow we can get that done and we can start in the spring and the kids can do their fishing. So what else do I have? I wanted to just say that I personally lost a friend, and our community lost an awesome woman, Mrs. Hudak, Susan L. Hudak, and I know that her family, you know, misses her a great deal, as we all do. I just want to give mention that we love Sue, still do, and I know that it's probably hard for Chris, whose birthday was yesterday. Chris, happy birthday in spite of. Just hope that the memories of your dear mother will comfort you, and you know, once the grieving process gets a little easier for the entire Hudak family. I don't think I have anything else, except for in the Fifth Ward, we were talking about in October starting a team. So we're going to do the Relay for Life this year. And I had proposed that each ward consider making a team for the Relay for Life. And we just wanted to raise awareness and have some of the community members come together and honor and celebrate those who have beat cancer and remember those who have been taken from us for cancer. So we do have a little team, the Fifth Ward. We're building our team now, Friends for Life. We're going to participate in the June 10th Relay for Life, which is going to be taking place in Clark. We're having a fundraiser, and thanks to the Linden Public Library, on April the 27th, we're going to host a paint party. So the idea is that you'll come, you'll paint a nice picture, you'll have pasta and Pinot Grigio, and you'll have a good time, and it's for a good cause. We don't get a lot of money off of it, but all of the proceeds that are going to come from this will go to the Fifth Ward Friends for Life team, and you know, go to the American Cancer Society. The event is on Eventbrite. If anybody's interested in it, please consider signing up, or you can send a check or whatever you want, and the organization sends us back some of the profits. So April 27th is 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. at the public library, and they're accommodating us because they close at 5 on Thursday, so we appreciate them for that. The last thing that I want to say is this year is this is my third term on council. I ran for city council because I believe that I could make a difference, and I know that in our community of Linden, the entire community of Linden, there are things that people don't know, they don't see. If we are here and we're trying to make progress, and to have other people who sit with you and serve with you and work with you turn around and try to defame you or lie to you, discredit you, it breaks my heart. So I vowed this year to be more out front with my concerns for the city, not just for the city taxpayers, but for the city employees, for the city residents, and for some of us here who sit here and get bullied as members of council by other members of council. So for 2017, I'm gonna say it plain. I'm gonna continue to say it like I always have, which is my consistency. I believe in my heart that there's a lot of corruption in the city of Linden, and I'm not gonna be a participant of any of it, period. As a member of council, we rely on the information that we are given by the so-called professionals and career civil servants. For us to have information changed, months later, after we were given specific information and guidance, is astounding. You cannot have two opinions on the same issue. Okay? That's what I'm saying. It's either white or black. There's no in between, period. You can't do one thing today and turn around and change the rules because you have a friend or someone that you have in your cipher that you need to take care of. That's inappropriate. That's not what I came here for. So I'm here to do the business of the city of Linden, and I hope that everybody here will take heed to that. The new members, the old members, don't threaten me because I don't take kindly to threats. You know, people want to go around you and behind your back and accuse you of doing anything. You can't accuse me of anything but being honest here, and I will continue to do that. So whoever does not like honesty, don't ask me a question. If there's a city employee who has an issue and who wants to tell their story or whatever their concerns are, you are protected by the state of New Jersey, and there's nothing these people can do about it, okay? But don't let them frighten you because of their political juice or their power or perceived power, because these same people that on their way up, they're gonna see them on the same way on the way down. Okay, and all the corrupt ones, it's gonna come back to you because the truth always comes out to the light, period. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Councilman Sadowski?
I'd like to say it. I have no report, but I'm sorry, I have to give you one. First with the Linden Roosevelt Sewage Authority. I'm a member of it, I'm the secretary of it, and Gary Fair's the executive director, so he gives me some of these to bring out to you. First of all, some of the board actions were they adopted Linden Property Holdings, the discharge permit. They adopted all permits required by the Emergency Preparedness Plan as required by the NJDEP. They passed a resolution setting the 2017 reorganizational meeting date. The plant operated in full compliance with its permit for the month of December. Executive Director, which is Gary Fair, was the guest speaker at the big meeting and dinner for the LIA meeting. And they liked his talk, plain English. The board approved the promotion of Richard Guerra to monitoring supervisor safety officer. Mr. Fair eventually is going to retire within the next year. And coming up, they are going to put out whatever it is, fearless, to get someone to take his place, but this is just starting. So if you hear something else about that, that's what's happening. From the Fire Bureau, first of all, I want to congratulate them. I was there at the fire, and I couldn't believe the job they were doing. I couldn't believe people were just doing exactly what they were supposed to be doing. There was no panic, there was nothing. The fire, the police, the OEM, all did a great job. So congratulations on that. Okay, from the fire department, the Fire Prevention Bureau collected fees for permits, inspections, and penalties totaling $6,767.72 for the month of January. Ambulance reimbursement system has departed $59,587.20 in revenue generated by the Linden Fire Department's Emergency Medical Service for the month of January 2017. The FMBA raised $3,500 to date through a breakfast hosted by Applebee's and T-shirt sales to support the son of one of the firefighters who was suffering from reflex neurovascular dystrophy disease. RND is a rare disease which affects the control of muscles. The FMBA will be holding its annual golf outing May 11th, 2017 at the Galloping Hill Golf Course. If anyone is interested, please contact Matt Pribish at the firehouse, 908 474 4550. And lastly, the FMBA will be holding its annual Fire Department Awards Dinner on February 25th. I will have a report on the awards presented at the dinner after they have it, and it will be at the March Council meeting. At the United Lock of Fire, I met Councilman Javitt there, and we spent an hour and a half just watching because we couldn't get in their way, and it was astounding what they could do. So, Chief Dooley and your group, congratulations. Almost finished. If you pass by Style Street, the old food fair building was sold, and if you could look at it, it's being fixed up. They're going to pave it. They put in new driveways, exits, and so on. The new company, Sieges, is doing this, but they're waiting for a little bit better weather to do, I guess, blacktop it and so on and so forth. But they have gotten rid of a lot of the garbage cars that were there, the wrecks, so they are working on it. I think maybe about a year, year and a half ago, I mentioned that on the corner of Cedar Avenue and Wood, there was a mailbox was knocked down by a truck and was never put up. Really, thanks to Dorothy Lolasher, who lives across the street, they finally put up the mailbox about 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks ago. So congratulations to Dorothy for being a pusher like that. And finally, on a sad note, we had to say goodbye to Sue Hudak. Sue, when I first started out 9 years ago, she was the first person to walk the streets with me when we were campaigning. And I have very fond memories of Sue walking the streets and then after that going for coffee and so on and so forth. Condolences to the family. If you pass by when they had the funeral, if you pass by Sixth School, the Sixth School put up a memorial in front of it. The principal, Bill Mastriano, and the teachers and the staff and the children painted, put up, drew, and so on, the memorial. And the funeral procession did pass Sixth School for Sue. Probably was the last time because she and the children went through Sixth School. So I'll miss Sue as a helper, but also as a friend. So Sue, please rest in peace. If you have any questions in the Sixth Ward concerning yourself, city problem, and so on and so forth, please give me a call. It's 862-0749. If I'm not there, my wife is usually there. If she's not there, please leave a message, and I will get back to you. The last thing real quickly is St. Teresa's School on Liberty Avenue has been closed for 3, 4, 5 years, but they are opening a charter school there in September. So it'll be a little bit more traffic down in that section. There is big enough parking lots to park, but it will be buses coming in, but that will be in September coming up. So any questions, please give me a call. Have a good evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman Sadowski. A question, the mailbox, what corner was that on?
It was the corner of Cedar and Woodlawn.
Is that for regular mail or you can put emails
there?
There
was a little store there, a truck delivering, backed into it, ripped it down, they took it away, and it's been over a year, and they finally put it back in.
And I can put my emails in there too?
It's still in the truck, no.
My emails? Okay.
Yeah. No, but they finally put it up, so.
Thank you, sir. Councilman Strano.
Thank you, Council President. In the Budget Review and Finance Committee, I have a small report. The payment of bills totaling $1,429,008.12. The bills have been signed by the Mayor, Council President. Mayor, Council President, and Finance Chairman, and a detailed check register and vouchers are on file in the clerk's office.
and we are in receipt of the investments made by the city treasurer for the month of February at the rate of 0.50%. I move for approval and ask for a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Crosby Hurling?
No.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Hickey?
Abstain.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes.
Okay. That's it for my committee chair reports. But I have an issue that's an ongoing saga with the 7th Ward, and particularly in the Trimley Point area. Of course, this problem, you know, radiates further than that. But it's the matter of a quiet zone designation for the at-grade railroad crossing on Lower Road. And I'm in receipt of a copy of a letter that was received in a clerk's office on February 15th of 2017. And in this ongoing matter, which has involved our city engineer, our fire chief, and if there's, I guess, our city clerk, a couple of our grant writers, and a couple of our consultants that have been trying to get this project moved forward. It's been a long, tedious project. We have a verbal affirmation from Conrail that they've accepted our plans as drawn up by George Virchik. But this letter is in the matter of the review of the railroad traffic control devices, the surface features, the roadway approaches, and quiet zone designation at the highway-rail at-grade crossing of Consolidated Rail Corporation's Linden Industrial Track and Lower Road in the city of Linden in the county of Union. And what this notice is about is that they're going to convene a meeting at the site tomorrow at 10:30, and they're going to go over all the particulars of this designation. And once this determination is agreed to, we can start putting our plan together to actually commence the construction of the different items that are going to be done by the city, and hopefully the railroad will agree to commence with their share of the project that they'll have to contribute to it, and hopefully in the somewhat near distant future we'll get this project completed, and we'll have that out of our way. On a sad note, going to repeat some of the comments that were made prior to my report. I'm very close to the Hudak family. There's no secret about that. And it was a heartbreaking tragedy that occurred 3 Sundays ago. As was mentioned, Sue Hudak, a very longtime member of the Board of Education and past president of the board, passed away suddenly and unexpectedly, leaving us all in a state of disbelief and shock. Sue is the wife of our former city attorney, John Hudak, the mother of freeholder Chris Hudak, his brother, JJ, and his sister, Megan. And as importantly, she was a friend to many of us here in Linden. Sue touched the lives of many children in the school system, including my own. She was the kind of person that would take a kid by the hand, you know, reassure them and comfort them, because I know she did it for my kids. the Linden school system, she will be sorely missed. And I would like the minutes of this council meeting to acknowledge and memorialize Sue in my report and the other reports as well. End of my report.
Thank you, Councilman. Councilwoman Yamakaitis.
Thank you, Council President. I'll start off with my committee report for the Personnel Committee. Did everyone get a copy? Any questions on the personnel report?
I have a comment.
Councilwoman Crosby?
Mm-hmm. So my comment is this. We did a hiring policy, or we revised the policy in 2011 when I was seated, and apparently everything that was done this new committee is going to undo, so it is what it is. But I just need to be clear that the reason that some of the changes were made was because that the people in Linden felt like the hiring was unfair to the majority of people who didn't have a relative in the city of Linden or who didn't have a political affiliation. So we stopped accepting resumes or applications where there was no vacancy. This edited policy seeks to do just that. Item number 9 calls for applications to be kept on file for a period of 6 months from the date of the original posting or upon exhaustion of the list, at which point they become destroyed. The only lists that we were keeping after the 2011 policy were the DPW seasonal lists or the civil service lists proper, where someone took an open competitive exam and then they were ranked on a list from the Civil Service Commission, of which the city of Linden participates. So now, if I apply for, or someone applies for a job and some that position is filled, the application is going to be held on file for 6 months, even though there might be other people in the future who might want to apply for different positions. So the idea is they might qualify for something else. That is awesome. And if they do qualify, they should apply just like everybody else. And they should have the same equal opportunity as everyone else, not be flagged or tagged or put in a certain folder for future positions that might become available. That was the problem in the past. People filled in applications and they left the position that you're applying for blank. That's not what open and equal opportunity employment is about. So I just wanted to call that out because this was changed in 2011 and now it's being changed in 2017, but there's only a small change on the members of council. So it begs the question, what are we trying to change and who are we changing it for? Because everybody in the city of Linden, according to the 2011 policy that we were using up until tonight, thought they were getting a fair and equal chance to apply for a job. So I just wanted to put that out there before the vote because I'm not going to support this.
Councilwoman Brown, you have comments on the same?
Yes. I just want to say I support Councilwoman Yamakaitis in the Personnel Committee. She allowed me to sit in her committee my first personnel meeting. She runs a tight ship there. And, you know, I just want to say this, is that it just seems like it's, we listen to one person, is her way or the highway. She has the best policies, exactly. This and that. Her changes are the best way. We discussed this yesterday in caucus, and it was dialogue as far as even everything, as far as the wording that should be put into the policy, making sure everybody was comfortable with it. Here we come on the floor, and someone wants to throw a Tampa tantrum that they're not getting their way and how it's not fair. But the reality is that mm-hmm. We came together, we talked it out, we felt like this is the best policy, and there's going to be other changes. But it just always seems like it's one individual that is her way, and if she doesn't like it, she wants to come out here and throw a temper tantrum. I just want to congratulate, and I just want to and point out that the personnel committee discussed this as a whole, 4 members, and then they came out and discussed it yesterday to 11 council members, and we discussed it as a whole. If one person disagrees with it, that's fine. But to sit up here and make it seem like this is a bad policy and every policy change that we make is bad is very misleading. You know, I don't want to steal the thunder of the councilwoman if she wants to explain the changes or even the city attorney, but I support this policy and I support the work that the committee's doing. End of comment.
Councilwoman Yamakaitis.
Thank you, Council President. And thank you, Councilman Brown. As Councilman Brown stated, we had a meeting with the Personnel Committee. We met with many of the department heads, heard their concerns about all the time it was taking doing interview processes and how we are getting such great applicants. And we are going to post every job. This posting policy is going to be posted on our city website. It's going to be posted in every building in the city, so all the city employees are aware of it. We've heard of some of the inconsistencies of the past one. I mean, residents, how many of you knew that you could only apply for a seasonal job in public works from January through June? I bet you most of you will say, I didn't know that. This is the stuff we want clear and concise, so everybody's aware of it. So, as Michelle Obama says, when they go low, we go high. So I'll continue with my personnel report. In the police department, the appointment of Daniel Gomes, voluntary intern, for the period of January 17, 2017, to May 10, 2017, at no cost to the city. The internship is for college credit. Number two, in the fire department, the appointment of Fire Lieutenant Greg Pulowski and Fire Lieutenant Christopher Rooney to the position of fire captain, effective March 1, 2017, salary commensurate with the salary ordinance, $124,000. The appointment of firefighter Mike Cassidy to the position of fire lieutenant, effective March 1, 2017, salary commensurate with the salary ordinance, $108,000. The appointment of firefighter Barry Kavrick to the position of fire lieutenant, effective March 1, 2017, salary commensurate with the salary ordinance, $108,000. Permission to begin background checks for fire candidates subject to a notification that said background checks are not offers of employment. Number three, in the office of the mayor, the appointment of Leanne F. White as confidential aide to the mayor at a salary of $37,000, subject to satisfactory completion of the city's background check policy, effective February 22, 2017. From the Personnel Division, FMLA request, employee number 000129, intermittent FMLA from January 12, 2017 to July 12, 2017. Employee number 908991, FMLA/NJFLA from January 23rd, 2017 to April 21st, 2017. Employee number 107414, intermittent FMLA from January 10th, 2017 to September 10th, 2017. The approval of the posting policy is number B. I move for approval and request a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Cosby Herling?
Yes to all, but I'm voting no for the posting policy.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Hickey?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes.
I would like to ask the firefighters who were promoted to please stand up, our lieutenants and captains. I'll continue. I have a message for some of our city employees. It's come to the attention of the Personnel Committee that some of you are being cyberbullied. Cyberbullying comes in many ways. It's not just for youth. It's adults, it's children. There should be zero tolerance. Unfortunately, some of our laws are very, are inadequate to deal with this. Cowards get away with hiding behind a keyboard and trying to ruin people's lives and hurt people. It's not a good thing. I want you to know that we sent a request to our law department to investigate, so if anybody feels that they are being cyberbullied, any of our employees, please call our personnel office. Mr. Ross's number is 474-5760. We will stand behind, I'm sure I could speak for most of the council, we'll stand behind you, anything we could do to support you. Unfortunately, some of the laws don't support it, but I could tell you personally, I will be reaching out to some of our legislators. This needs to stop. We can't expect the kids to do any better if we have adults behaving in this matter. Many of us city officials, same thing. You know, unfortunately, you have to grin and bear it, but it's still not nice. Some of the research we were doing, if anybody goes on some of these sites, they just tell you, just everybody posts the word a four-letter word, stop. You know, it's ridiculous. So I will move on from there. So like I said, anybody that feels they need to speak to our labor attorney, please feel free to do so. I'll continue with the 8th Ward report. I just have a few things. Restriping of Greer Avenue was completed recently after the road construction with the gas and water companies. So many of the speed stripes were put in, the crosswalk, so it's looking good. I spoke to Chief Parham, and he assured me that our traffic studies that I have on hold right now will be some of the first ones looked at. Right now, there's a little backup with it. We've had some retirements in the police department, so there's some retraining going on with some of our officers in the traffic bureau. So thank you for being patient. And I have a message from the Linden Pulaski Parade Committee. They're looking for candidates for the 2017 Miss and Junior Miss Polonia to represent the City of Linden and St. Teresa Church in the Pulaski Day Parade in New York. The age range for Miss Polonia is 16 to 22 years old, and Junior Miss is 8 to 15 years old. No, they don't have a Mr. Polonia. Sorry, guys. If anybody knows any candidates, please give us a call. You could call to receive an application, Samantha Lucenda, at 908-494-6695, or you could call me, Michelle Yamakaitis, at 908-925-2309. And lastly, can't forget our little furry friends. Folis is having their pancake breakfast at Applebee's on March 22nd from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. The cost is $12 per person. For more information, you could call 908-718-7163. I'll have that information on Folis posted on my Facebook page as well. And that concludes my report, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Councilman Medina.
Yes, thank you, Council President. Good evening, everyone. Sometimes it's a little bit difficult to kind of go towards the tail end of the dais here after all these reports, but I do. I just want to give a quick thank you to DPW. Did an amazing job again. The men were out there, and the women. They did an amazing job, and it worked with the people. Again, this city is known for its great service, and it's something that Mr. Micucci and Mr. Venditto and all the guys over there and DPW are working really hard to show the people and the residents that we want to provide a good service in the city of Linden. Also want to congratulate the men that were just promoted tonight. Congratulations, guys. Not everyone do what you guys do. I know I don't. So, and I hope I never, ever have to experience the need for your services, but I'm glad that you're right around the corner. So thank you and congratulations for on your promotion. Well deserved. I do have a quick library report. So starting in March to May, they're having a fundraiser, Friends of Linden Library, every first Monday of the month. So Wendy's right on Wood Avenue is in March, Buffalo Wild Wings is in April, and Moe's is in May. So, but you do have to go to the circulation desk at the library to obtain the flyer, so that way the 10% or whatever the percentage is, I believe it's 10%, will go towards the Friends of Linden Library to, again, help fund a lot of these programs that are run in the library for the children of Linden. Also, there's a book sale in the second weekend of May. Any information that you need or require or anything that you want to know about when it comes to the Friends of Linden Library, you can find it at the circulation desk. A lot of good information. Again, a lot of these programs are no charge to the parents. It's very beneficial to our children. For their future growth and development. So I always encourage that. For the 9th Ward, we have a few things. Again, I mentioned last month, road paving will be starting hopefully next few months. I know our city engineer has been working really hard on that list. Also, I did throw a little wrench into his wheel on Northwood Avenue between Raritan Road and Amsterdam. It's a city-owned strip. So Wood Avenue, that's not a county road. I was able to get in contact with Councilman Bishop and Roselle. Obviously, we're not going to pave only one half of Northwood Avenue because that just doesn't make any sense. So I know our engineer is in the process of trying to obtain an emergency grant to pave that road. It will take a lot of money to pave that long stretch of road. Roselle is also doing the same thing. So I'm hoping if it's not in 2017, definitely in 2018. That road is such a bad shape and the people there are constantly complaining, both on the Linden and the Roselle side. And again, it's just better to join forces to come up with a solution that works for both townships. And hopefully we'll see that come into fruition. Again, I'm really crossing my fingers for 2017, but it might be 2018, but I'll let our city engineer kind of update us on the status of those grants. Also, I've been receiving a lot of complaints on DeWitt Terrace, especially Academy Terrace, and also Edgewood near McManus, also Deerfield, basically all the school in Highland. You know, I just asked all the parents. I'm a parent, but I'm not at that level yet where I'm taking my child to school. Leave early. Try not to block the road. Try not to drop off your kid in the middle of the road. I've seen that happen so many times. Cars are going around cars. And I just cringe because the thought. That's why I want to congratulate these guys, because these guys see all these injuries and see these accidents, and it will break my heart to see a kid get hit by a car. And it has happened on DeWitt Terrace. I believe it happened in 14, where families crossing Academy and DeWitt, and a car went around another car, stopped at the intersection there. But I see these parents. They want to make their own rules. I understand people, they're trying to get to work, but think of your child's safety first. If you have to park a block away, walk your child, or just monitor your child. We do have crossing guards, and the police are aware of the issues. They're trying to curb these issues. I know Councilwoman Hickey also have the same issues as well. We share the same issue because Highland and Deerfield are right on the borderline of 9th Ward and 10th. So we're working on it. I get all the complaints, working on it. It's been a problem for years and years, and I don't think it's ever going to go away. It's more educating the people and just trying to bring awareness to the issue, and hopefully parents will just follow the laws a little bit and be patient and leave a little bit early. So we're working on it. So also, just want to make sure I don't miss anything. I think I've got almost everything covered, but I just want to echo Councilman Strano on Ms. Hudak, 9th Ward resident, very instrumental in helping me with the permit parking between all 9 side streets between Orchard and Northwood Avenue. She was always vocal when it came to issues around the community. She would drive around and say, "Armando, we got a storm drain loose, or we got a pothole here." You know, other folks here have longer relationship, but I had the opportunity to get to know her a little bit better over the last 4 years, and it was such a shock to hear about her untimely passing, because I literally was on the phone with her on Friday discussing people parking illegally overnight on Robinwood Terrace and throwing their bags of Wendy's on the street. And, you know, and I was just getting back to her, "Hey, I spoke to the chief. We're going to get someone out there and start enforcing the permit parking there." And then I heard what happened on Sunday, and it was just heartbreaking to hear that horrible news. We also lost another great member of the 9th Ward community, Officer Novak. I grieve for his family, grieve for his children. They're young. And just terrible to hear these untimely passings. It really is terrible. It's just terrible. You kind of just question yourself and question your own faith, and always think there's something better. But just want to keep those two families and our thoughts, prayers for strength within their families and friends. I'm always reachable by cell phone, email, text, 908-986-6100. Email me at amedina@linden-nj.org. I'm always here to help and assist with any concerns. That concludes my report. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman. Councilwoman Hickey.
Good evening, everybody. First, I just want to start off as liaison to the Office of Emergency Management, 2016 report of OEM responses to incidents that have happened in the city. We had 127 of them, 13 high school sports, 15 fires, 9 vehicle accidents, 4 rainstorms with flooding and power outages, 3 snowstorms, 3 fuel spills, 15 trees, poles, and or wires down, 8 traffic lights incidents that were out, 11 special events, 1 active shooter, 2 suspicious packages, 1 helicopter crash, 1 brush fire, 3 water main breaks, a smoking manhole, a car fire, a truck stuck under a railroad bridge, and 1 assistance to DPW while they removed snow. Additionally, requests were also made for barricades, portable stop signs, and cones for different incidents. The volunteer man hours for 2016 was 1,227. Comp man hours was 270 and a half, with a total hours put in by our OEM members at 1,497 and a half hours. And this is one of the reasons why I always stick up for our Office of Emergency Management. Now with Captain Dave Hart in charge, we're moving forward. Our OEM members are getting trained. We've upgraded our computer equipment. We've got additional vehicles. And I'm very proud of all the work that they're all doing for the city of Linden. Additionally, I'd like to thank the DPW on the last snowstorm. They really, truly made an amazing job. I had many messages from residents just saying, thank you. What a great, great job you did. And that doesn't always happen. I did not get one complaint about snow. So really, really a great, great job, and it's really appreciated. I also want to let residents know that, you know, I've seen in the area many times plumbers, plumbing trucks at residents' homes. You know, I want to let residents know that if it's an issue with backup or drainage in your basement, you know, the City and Public Works Department does have a very expensive camera equipment that we are able to detect where the issue is before you're spending. Well, I don't want to put the plumbers out of business, too, in my work, but you know, extravagant amounts of money that, you know, none of us can really afford to take care of this when we have the services offered to you from the city. The Public Works phone number is 908-474-8666. If it's any emergency issues, you can always contact me and I can try and get things done a little, expedited a little bit more quickly. Our gas lines, phase one, is being done in the 10th Ward. I thank everybody for their patience. Skoda has been doing an amazing job. I haven't really had any complaints, and I've been very content with the work that they do. We're going to have phase two, as I've mentioned before, our street paving and everything, a lot of it's on hold, so we can make sure we get the most out of the money that we're allotted for the 10th Ward's paving as well. Let's see. I wanted to thank everybody who has attended casino night last month for the Linden Housing Authority. Unfortunately, Ann Ferguson wasn't in attendance. She was ill, but she is on a fast recovery, and I expect her back in work in a couple weeks, and I just hope everyone keeps her in their thoughts and prayers. On March 11th, the Union County St. Patrick's Day Parade kicks off in Union. It's a wonderful event every year, a huge, big parade, and I hope many of you attend. It's a great day to be Irish. Congratulations to the firemen. Another fire I attended the other night, just, it's amazing the job that you do. And you represent the city proudly. You truly, truly do. I'd like to send my thoughts and prayers and condolences to 10th Ward residents Eliano and Isidro Rodriguez in the loss of their brother-in-law and our police officer, Michael Novak. Like Armando, Councilman Medina said, it's been a sad, sad couple weeks. The sudden death of Sue Hudak. Sue, always the first one to help, the first one to bring you cookies and cake, the first one to hand out flyers for you. So suddenly, it's very upsetting for many of us, and she was definitely an asset to our city. Let's see. Speeding, many complaints of speeding. Our previous councilman, Councilman Minarchenko, I hope he's listening, because if I hear him complain to me one more time about speeding on Princeton Road by Lenape, speeding up to the light, I am going to start having radar done there, so anyone that's speeding up to catch the light, so Mr. Minarchenko stops harassing me, we'll be getting tickets. Really, the safety for our kids and our family, it's such a shame. It almost makes you leery on paving these roads, because I know the roads are bad there right now with potholes and so forth. Like, I can't imagine what kind of speedway it's going to be when we pave it, and I have it in line to be paved. So this does really, truly worry me. And lastly, I'd just like to give a special shout-out to a special person in our city. I didn't realize until a few weeks ago, friends of ours who live in the Second Ward, Pat and Rick Ordner, they're always very dedicated in the community, always helping, whether it be with fire pits for the Cultural and Heritage Committee or helping other people in the community. They have a son, Michael. Michael is handicapped, but Michael is a very, very special guy. I didn't realize until a few weeks ago that he is totally dedicated to watching our council meetings every single month. The littlest change that happens, Michael notices. And he works at Rowie Hospital, and he assists people every day. And he's just an amazing young fellow. And Michael, we appreciate you watching all of us. And we all just want to say hi to you and thank you for worrying about our city. And I hope everyone has a great night. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilwoman Hickey. Mayor, your report?
Yes, good evening, everybody. For those of you who follow Linden High School basketball, it's the end of the first quarter, Linden 9, St. Mary 7. So I'll try to keep you posted as we go on this evening. I'm a big high school basketball fan for all you folks out there. Good news this evening, ladies and gentlemen. The state appellate court has ruled in our favor with regards to the ShopRite lawsuit. As you all know, that particular litigation has tied up that property for a considerable amount of time, and it looks like the only chance they have now is to go to the Supreme Court. And I think, if I'm correct me if I'm wrong, Dan, I think they've run out of time for that as well. I believe they've run out of time for that. So I think the whole ShopRite lawsuit litigation is behind us. And in fact, next week, I'll be meeting with the Linden Economic Development Corporation, who's headed with Rich Purcell. We'll be meeting with the people from Duke Realty, and we'll be meeting with Ed Cantor, who owns property on US 109. We will be looking to declare that an area in need of redevelopment so that we can get that development jump started. I'm not sure whether or not Walmart will be going there or not, but we do know that some sort of retail, it's very likely that some sort of retail will wind up on US 109 on that corridor. The other good news I have tonight is we are declaring on St. George Avenue a developer, VVR Developers. This particular firm, they come with significant financial backing, and they are very interested in moving forward with the project. We'll be meeting with our NW Financial, and we'll be meeting with Mike Frangella from our tax department to figure out how we should proceed financially, what type of compensation the city should receive for the property, and what type of agreement we should make with regards to taxes over the next 30 years for that property. And as you all know, we've spent over $5 million in acquisition and demolition for that property, and this is over 10 years now that we've been paying on we've been paying on that note. So we've been basically spending money and covering that note and with nothing coming in for over 10 years now. And I think it's high time that we get this project jump started. It's a very nice project. The plans that were presented to my office, I've on a number of occasions have showed at the council meeting, and I really feel that the project is going to be a tremendous success. It is what St. George Avenue needs, and it's long overdue. Next, I'd like to report on the My Linden First program. Last month, I would have liked to have a report that we, under My Linden First program, under the Economic Development Corporation in my office, we have basically secured a contract with Blue Apron, where they have hired us to do the vetting for employees, for potential employees in their company. So we've been assigned the task of hiring upwards of 500 people. While we know they need upwards of 2,000 people, we've a contract for 500. So anyone interested in working at Blue Apron, please, you can contact my office, or you can pre-register online at cic-nj.org, or you can call 908-472-7734. And Special thanks goes out to Pastor Pam Jones, who runs CIC, because in 2015, she collaborated with our office to try to establish a Linden, First program. She was doing it for nothing, just to see Linden residents placed in decent employment opportunities. She did it from the bottom of her heart, and no one knew that it would evolve into us landing a contract where she could actually receive some compensation for all the hard work that she has done. And to date, with Blue Apron, but to date, we placed over 200 people and jobs throughout the city and in other areas that are not in the city. So special thanks to her for her hard work and dedication. And last but not least, it pains me to have to discuss certain things, and I promise you all that the day that I leave politics, I will only come here to wish those who follow me good luck. I will not be trying to disrupt your objectives. I will do everything in my power to see to it that others are successful, as we all should. Unfortunately, that is not the case with our former mayor. I am in receipt of an Oprah request, where he is issued by the clerk's office. He's asking for copies of all certificates of marriage issued by the City of Linden from January 1st, 2015 to present for weddings performed by Mayor Derek Armstead, together with the amount of money collected each year by the City of Linden for each marriage. The amounts collected and distributed to any charities in connection with said marriages, together with any and all forms executed by the married couples related to the distribution of said funds and charities, including copies of checks from the city to said charities, together with all correspondence sent and received in relation to same. Now, just so you know, I perform weddings in the City of Linden. Every wedding I perform, the couple has to pay $100. Now, state law says I cannot accept that $100 for my own benefit. So what I did was research the issue, and it was found out that you can take that $100 and you can donate it to a charity, a 501c3 of your choice. You allow the couples who are getting married to choose. So couples have been choosing to donate to CIC, which you've heard, they do my job program, and they've donated to the Linden Boxing Association in Linden. So what we've done with that money is tremendous. If a person comes and they have a death in the family and they can't afford the funeral expenses, we send money for funeral expenses. If we've given several dollars in scholarships. I think last year we gave over $5,000 in scholarships to Linden High School residents. It was $5,000, and we also gave scholarships out to Linden students who were attending Union County College. So we've done some good things. If a resident comes in and they have some damage to their home and they find themselves falling short with insurance, we have them fill out forms and we try to help offset some of the costs. And of course, if they're seniors and they qualify, we try to do a lot of good things with this money. So shame on former Mayor Gabunka if he didn't do his homework and find out that you could do other things with the money. And shame on him for trying to dig up something that is meant to be good. I just think it's just sad that in this day and time that you just can't move on. Let it go. We're doing good things with the money, with the people in our community, and we shall continue to do such. That concludes my report, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mayor. Councilwoman Hickey was excused because there's a little problem in the 10th Ward. She needs to be with some of the people over there.
You've been excused?
You want excused?
Yes, you're excused.
All I want to say is my condolences to the Hudak family. Sue and I were very good friends. Every time I needed any type of help, she came forward and helped me out. And since she knows that I work a lot with the kids, she was always there for whatever I needed. Maybe with the soccer, We started the special needs kids, and she was the one who set everything up with the county. Even on Halloween, she would show up with her big hat, always with a smile on her face, and she was always there. She, good friend, she was always there to help everybody out, and she's going to be missed. Really sorry this happened. Resolutions 2017-97 through 2017-130. The papers only says 129. There's an extra sheet there for number 130. Anybody wants any resolutions to be taken aside? Yes, ma'am. 97. 104.
104.
108. 108.
And 127.
127. That's on the. No, you can make a comment. Yeah. That would be, you can make a comment, but we're not there yet. Ms. Malik. 99, 100, 102, 103, 105, 110, 113, 117, 123, 128. Anybody else? Okay, can I please have a motion for resolutions 97 through 129 with the exceptions of 97, 104, 108, 127, 99, 100, 102, 103, 105, 110, 113, 117, 123, and 128.
I make a motion and ask for a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond.
Yes.
Javik.
Yes.
Brown.
Yes.
Brooks.
Yes.
Crosby Hurling. I'm sorry. Sadowski.
Yes.
Strano.
Yes.
Yamakaitis.
Yes.
Medina.
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez.
Yes. Okay, Ms. Wolverdine, let's start with you and with number 97. There's no numbers crossed. 97.
This talks about the grant for Elizabeth Avenue for streetscape and pedestrian safety improvement projects. I was just wondering what exactly they're going to do for the pedestrian safety improvement projects.
Okay, before I pull Mr. Vercek, this is something that's been going on for a while now. I don't know if you have seen a couple of other towns. It seems like everybody's getting a similar grant. I work in Melbourne, and they just did the exact same thing in Melbourne. They will be making the sidewalks wider, slow down traffic, and make more pedestrian traffic. That's the main point that comes from the grant. Mr. Vercek will be able to explain the rest. Streetscape, I'm sure it's including trees and lights.
Okay, so if they make the sidewalks wider, then there'll be no parking along Elizabeth Avenue?
That's incorrect. There is, right now, enough width on Wood Avenue to make two lanes each way. And we're not going to cut it down that much. We're going to grab the sidewalk about, George, correct me on this, 4 feet on each side, which is going to make the ways going each way smaller, which you will not be able to have two cars going through it on each side.
Council President?
Yeah.
Council President?
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, she's talking about Elizabeth Avenue. Not Wood Avenue. So the,
talking about Wood Avenue, right?
No. On this one, it's Elizabeth Avenue.
Oh, my mistake.
But George, that's okay.
So on Elizabeth Avenue, the changes that are going to be made on Elizabeth Avenue is the crosswalks are going to be done, redesigned. The corners, correct me if I'm wrong, George, those are going to be bumped out a little bit more. There's going to be better lighting in those areas as well. So
when you mean bumped out,
Like if you go in the corner of Elizabeth Avenue and Wood Avenue, right in front of 10 Wood Avenue,
mm-hmm.
that corner right there, it's too narrow as far as for pedestrians to stand on. So that may be bumped out a little bit more, where cars are going to have to take a little bit wider turn and more pedestrians are going to be able to be at that corner. This is all going through an engineering firm, and the crosswalks are going to be redesigned and relocated to create a shorter path for pedestrians to walk on. There's going to be other lights put at this intersection as well, so it's better lit since most of the
accidents lighting, happen. I think, is real important. I don't know about the bumping out, because a lot of people stand in the street when they're waiting for the light to change, and they should be on the sidewalk to begin with, you know?
Well, I cross that sidewalk's my ward, and that sidewalk is very narrow, right in front of that location, 10 Wood Avenue. That was something that the DOT narrow. Actually, I walked with them, and this is something, a recommendation that's coming from them as well. They even stated that
they used to have a police officer there helping when the train traffic would, you know, during the rush hour time, and I think that was helpful, because some people cut through the middle of the street, and that's bad, but I think lighting is very, very important. And I think it's important to have a police officer there to tell these people, you don't cut in front of the cars, you go to the crosswalk.
I can't speak for the police department, or I do know is that at the time that we did have police officers there, we may have had the same number or maybe more police officers. You know, the resources of our police department are very slim as far as manpower. They were out there trying to get the word out to have pedestrians use the crosswalks. When they were out there, pedestrians were. But when they're not, pedestrians aren't. So it's like, you know, to have a officer there actually on overtime is very hard, especially when they're trying to man.
Because I know in the morning when I'm going to work, they'll be coming out of the condos there at 10, and they'll just cut straight across. It's like, you know.
Okay, Ms. Wolverine, next one. Okay, you got your answer? Let's move to the next one.
Well, let me do it.
You too?
Well, I'm going to.
Okay.
Okay, are you talking about under the bridge or up more?
About cross. They're all.
Yeah. It's like if you remember a couple of years ago, 2 years, whatever it was, three. The city put barriers in, and they had the policemen there. And what did the people do? They stepped over the barriers and still crossed in the middle. But I remember them putting the barriers up, and I can remember people actually tripping over them and falling. So that might be it. You might have to have police presence.
Yeah, but I think lighting is a good idea. Okay, thank you.
104, ma'am. You're right here. Let's keep you for all of them.
All right. Is this the building behind the promenade, 384? Because this is 401 right here. Is that big brick building that's been empty for so long behind the promenade?
Ms. Antonelli, 384 North Wood Avenue.
Yeah, it's my understanding. Yes, it is, to answer your question. This had to do with actually two prior resolutions where the city went out to bid to lease certain parking spaces. I believe it was approximately 50 parking spaces in the back of the promenade there. There now is a redeveloper interested in developing that property. I believe it's going to be a lab of some sort that does drug testing through urine and blood draws. So just as a precautionary measure, city council is now rescinding the prior awards. There's actually two resolutions, prior award of the lease of the parking spaces. That person is no longer the owner of the property.
So are they taking over the whole building?
It's my understanding they're taking over both floors, but it's being done in phases.
So we'll finally get ratables from that building?
That is correct.
Hallelujah, thank you.
Don't go away, ma'am. First, I want to say Mayor was also excused. We have an incident on the 10th Ward, and he went over there to see what can be done.
St. George's Avenue, yeah.
In St. George Avenue?
Yeah. Suspicious package.
108?
I always go nuts when I see all this money being spent on the landfill. What exactly still has to be done, and when are we going to be doing something to turn that around so we might actually be making some money off of solar panels or something with that dump? It just drives me nuts when I see this amount. So what is this?
Me too.
What is this half a million going for?
George?
This is for the maintenance of the landfill. It's going to pay for the engineer for the year 2017. And if there's any major problems that have to be fixed, it'll be corrected. And the I believe there's also a resolution to get a study done by an outside consultant, and he'll make some recommendations, maybe even take over the maintenance in the future.
Because I have suggested in the past that possibly we hire, for your department, more engineers for us to do this, and instead of us always, you know, having to hire someone out from the outside for $500,000.
We are, I believe we're getting close to the end of that. George, how many more years we have on this? About 12 more? 8 more?
I'm not exactly sure. It was 20 years, but the DP might have extended it. But I think it's somewhere in the 2020s.
We're getting closer.
I know, but isn't there, and you're an engineer, isn't there a way we could start hiring a few more engineers to take this over at a lesser cost?
Yes, it's always a way to do a lesser cost, but we have to follow the DEP, the EPA, and
right, but get those people certified, you know, so they don't, but something to look into, because this
we will, and the whole $500 is not for the engineers, though. I'm not defending anybody, I'm just saying it's not. Don't go away, you have one more. 127?
127, okay. I see we're hiring somebody for $130 an hour for snow plowing and hauling services, and I know our snow plowing services from the city are really good. We've had a mild winter. We only had one major snowstorm last year. But what's this other part about hauling services? What the heck are they hauling?
Okay, it's the answer to this is a yes and a no, and I'll have Mr. McCucci answer better. Frank, can you please come up?
All this was is as a backup plan for anything to happen if we lost a truck or if we had a big snowstorm where we need additional trucks to haul snow. When it's $130 an hour going to 25,000 maxed out, only if we need them. That's all it is. We're not paying them right now. Mm-hmm. We're not using them right now.
You couldn't find anybody cheaper?
Well, believe it or not, that's cheap.
Really?
Yeah, because we're not using pickup trucks here. We're using tandem dump trucks. So we're
how many dump
most
trucks
of our
trucks
all, most of our dump trucks have desalters on them. So we have limited actual hauling trucks. Mm-hmm. So when we're doing snow removal, we bring them in, we get the job done faster, and it's really cheaper on the city in the long run.
And what's the hauling?
That's the hauling part
of
with the snow.
Snow?
With the snow. Yeah,
okay,
like
so
when
this
we
is all snow
having,
related.
It's all snow related. But if we have a big major storm, these trucks come in as a bigger truck and they help us push the heavier snow, so this way we don't have to have what we went through last year with the big blizzard. So it just makes things easier. But again, it's as needed if we need it.
Okay. If the storm is really that bad, because they did a great job for this past storm.
Yeah, thank you everybody. Yeah. The guys are really proud of what they've done. They did a great job for the city. But this is just precautionary measurement.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Thank you, Frank. Yeah. Can I have a motion for resolution 97, 104, 108, and 127, please?
Oh, make a motion and ask for a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Ms. Malik, can you please come up? We'll start with 99.
I've read on a number of other resolutions that PESCAC data service, well, they were providing a service. So if they're providing a service, what is the 67,000 plus for the cooler? And what, first off, what is the cooler? And why are we paying for this while we're paying also for this service?
Mrs. Sack, can you answer that, please?
Sure. There was a need in the police department to relocate their computer and server equipment from the present area due to flooding. Mm-hmm. And with that project, they needed to retain the services for removing and moving that computer equipment and related cooling systems. They had to make sure that the purchase of the moving of the computer systems also included the cooling systems. So this item was, I believe we went to bid, and this is the vendor that came back at the lowest bid.
So we lost the cooling system that we had, and this is to replace the other cooling?
Basically, yeah, due to some issues that they had in flooding.
Very good, thank you.
100?
100, okay. Just to segue off of what was just said here about the landfill, so we're having this feasibility study. Are they going to be looking at, like in the past we heard gas recovery, solar panel, why is this needed? I mean, whatever happened to the past options that were looked at for our landfill?
I believe the solar panels we're still working on. But Mr. Antonelli, do you know what else they're going to be doing?
I believe this is just a feasibility to study to see, as the engineer indicated, either perhaps leading to something where they take over maintenance, but obviously to make it, I guess, more profitable, if you will. So they're going to come up with some proposals for us. This entity, it's my understanding, has been involved in other landfills and essentially taking it away, or the responsibility to maintain them away from the municipality. Allow the municipality to generate some revenue while they do something with it as well.
So is this really free, or are we going to be obligated in the future to throw the business to them?
Sure. At this point, the feasibility study is at no cost to the city. However, in the future, depending upon a project, we'll determine if we go out to bid, or the mechanism to award a contract will be determined at that time.
But at this point, there's no obligation for?
Correct.
Okay.
102.
What are the tasks here? The resolution amending a contract with New Jersey Audubon and for $28,000. So what's being done with this?
Mr. Bodick, you,
sure.
102.
It's tied to the ACO. We've done this every year since the ACO. They were appointed the stewards of the landfill, and they run a number of programs and other activities at the landfill, in particular in conjunction with our student population, and providing them a lab in the field, in essence. And those are the activities that are being funded here.
For the $28,000?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
103?
The question that I have here is, is there some sort of a redistribution of homes, you know, residential, commercial sites that we have to have someone maintaining tax maps?
A lot of the times, and all the cities do this, has to be done if there is subdivisions, or sometimes you get 2-3 lots together to make a different site. If there's going to be a land vacated, if the streets are going to be vacated, all this has to be kept up every year. All the cities do it.
So why can't we do it ourselves instead of contracting out? I mean, it's a small amount, but...
Remington and Verneck, and they've been doing it since the beginning. So they have...
For the city of Linden, they've been doing it.
For the city of Linden, and a bunch of other cities also. But for the city of Linden, they're the ones who have everything.
Fine.
105?
105. This is kind of strange here. Qualifying certain professionals to provide services for special counsel. So I assume that these are lawyers. But just out of curiosity, why do they have to be qualified?
Mr. Bodick, 105?
Sure. In January, well, the city goes out to RFP and RFQ process for its professionals. In January, there was a resolution that probably had a large amount of firms and individuals. These were two specialties that weren't covered. The special counsel service is to assist the clerk's office in responding to some of the technical ends of OPA request, and the other was to provide engineering and environmental services at the landfill.
But it says here to provide services for special counsel, so they're not lawyers then?
Yes, there are lawyers.
Oh, they're lawyers, okay. And but my question is about qualifying them.
It's the RFP, RFQ process, the same one that there was a large resolution in January on with large amounts.
All right, so what type of, do they have, what type of qualifications do
they have? They respond to the RFP that is put out by the city, and they RFQ that is put out by the city, and they respond to them with their qualifications and that they meet their qualifications.
Okay.
In other words, anybody who's going to be doing any work for us, not necessarily today, but later on they want to come out and apply for some work, we have to make sure that they're lawyers, that they're engineers, and that's the RFQ.
Simple English versus that. Very good. Okay.
110.
110. All right, three questions here. What's being done, or what is done, why no one in the city can do this, and where does the money come from for the home improvement program?
Mr. Virchek, can you please answer 2017-110?
The money comes from the county through the federal government. It's a grant. They do the estimates, they do the inspection of all construction on home improvements throughout the city. We have some senior grants, they inspect those, they do the specs, they do the inspections, the payments, so they run the entire program.
So I've seen in the past, like, flyers coming to my house, like, if you want to have this done or that done, so this is like a subsidized home improvement program? Is that a way to look at it?
Yes.
Okay.
113.
Simple. Why do we need this, and what are the services done for the 17-5?
Basically, it's very simple. Okay. With the laws changing constantly, you have counsel, you have lawyers that dedicate themselves to specific things. We are hiring a lawyer as needed. Not necessarily is going to be in the office all the time. But OPRA, which is any documents that can be given out to the public, there's certain things that cannot go out, or certain things that I'm sure you have seen has to be blacked out or something. And according to the laws, who better can keep up with the laws than the lawyer in this specific thing, which is OPRA's.
Okay, so only things that are for our eyes actually comes out.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
117.
This sounds like that we're having like a subcontract here. So why do we need them? And I call it as a subcontractor. Why can't we just do this ourselves?
George, can you answer this? Before you do, Pannoni Associates are the ones who have been from the beginning with the streetscape, correct?
117.
They're going to be doing the inspection of the streetscape. Federal law says that the designer cannot inspect it, so they're going to be providing full-time inspection. They're going to be providing engineering services to adhere to all the federal regulations.
And we need an outside person. We can't do it in-house ourselves.
You have to be full-time, and you have to have certain certifications, which we do not have. Our inspectors are just lay people.
So we don't have PEs in the city?
We don't have somebody we could put full-time on his job 8 hours a day for 6 months.
Okay, good enough.
123, ma'am?
Simple. What do they do? I mean, this Richie planning for on-call planning services. First off, define, what is on-call planning services?
Mr. Bodick, 123?
Yes, on a number of the projects, especially the redevelopment projects, the council needs a report to formalize that. Ricky Planning reviews the master plan for the city of Linden and notes whether or not the proposals are in compliance with that master plan. Since it's on call, what it's referencing is that it's only when we need to provide those services, because Mr. Rickey also provides separate services to the planning board.
Such
this
as?
This is from the sitting end.
Such as?
He's a planner.
Okay.
He's the one who did the master plan for us also. So when there's questions that are needed from a planner, then that's the one who we will call when we need it.
So the same way
if you're a client and you're building a building or a site plan, you will bring your own planner, the same way you bring your architect and everything.
So he's not our city planner. Do we have a city planner?
He's our city
planner. Yes, he is.
So he is our city planner.
This is in a role other than that as city planner. This is for, I would say, the council side of some of these issues that need reports written.
So for consultation and questions
right.
and stuff
Correct.
Like that?
Correct, exactly.
Okay, fine.
Council President, if I could just add to that.
Yes.
And also what Mr. Rickey does is when we do a redevelopment project, there's a redevelopment plan that gets constituted. He is the one that constructs that redevelopment plan. And I'd be remiss if I didn't say that there are often times through the redevelopment process, while the city may pay Mr. Rickey for his services, we're able to get reimbursed by the redeveloper for some of those services, as with the attorney as well.
Is he a full-time employee?
No, he's not an employee. He's a 1099 contractor.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay, last but not least, 128.
All right, so is this in preparation to sell off this land, you know, to have someone to do the appraisal?
Yes. This is the land down St. George between Charles and John and Bauer, I think it is.
So will they knock down some buildings right past the railroad station? Is that the area that you're
yes.
talking about?
Yes, yeah, that's the
okay.
area.
Very good. Answer my questions.
Okay, I need a motion for resolutions 99, 100, 102, 103, 105, 110, 113, 117, 123, and 128, please.
I make a motion, ask for a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. At this time, we're going with ordinance first readings.
No, sir, sir.
Yes.
There was a resolution
in
front of the public.
Yes, I forgot.
That did not.
Thank you, Mr. Bodek. We have one more resolution, 2017-130, that was added today. They are copies of them right here in the front. I will have Mr. Bodek read it before we get a motion on it.
Whereas the New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection Green Acres Program provides loans and or grants to municipal and county governments and grants to nonprofit organizations for assistance in the acquisition, development, and stewardship of lands for outdoor recreation and conservation purposes. And whereas the New Jersey Audubon Society, in partnership with the City of Linden, desires to further the public interest by obtaining funding in the amount of $868,925 from the state to fund the following projects. Hawk Rise Final Plans. Hawk Rise provides scenic and environmental vibrant walking trails and ample bird watching opportunities to an area that prior to development was gated off and hidden behind industrial land uses. The site, a 95-acre ecological preserve and wetlands complex in Linden, was carved out of a former landfill, and within it contains an abundance of diverse habitats for a relatively small and urban location. This application formulates the final stages of the Hawkeye Sanctuary development and intends to complete the unfinished trails in the sanctuary, finalize tourist-related infrastructure, complete signage and information boards in the park, continue the conservation of this beautiful open and mixed development space, and continue meeting the recreational needs of the surrounding community at a cost of $1,737,850. Now, therefore, the governing body resolves the New Jersey Audubon Society, or the successor to the Office of the Mayor of the City of Linden, is hereby authorized to A, make application for such a loan and or grant, B, provide additional application information and furnish such documents as may be required, and C, act as the authorized representative of the above-named applicant. And whereas the state shall determine if the application is complete and in conformance with the scope and intent of the Green Acres Program and notify the applicant of the amount of the funding awarded. And whereas the applicant is willing to use the state's funds in accordance with such rules, regulations, and application statutes, and is willing to enter into an agreement with the state for the above-named project. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Council of the City of Linden, one, that the mayor of the above-named body or board is hereby authorized to execute an agreement and any amendments thereto with the state, known as Hawkeye Sanctuary. Two, that the City of Linden will provide the matching share of the project at no cost to the New Jersey Audubon, if a match is required, in the amount of $868,925. Three, that the event that the state funds are less than the total project specified above, the applicant has the balance of funding necessary to complete the project. Four, that the applicant agrees to comply with all applicable federal, state, and local laws, rules, and regulations in its performance of the project. And five, that this resolution shall take effect immediately.
Any questions? Anybody wants to come up and make comments? May I have a motion for 2017-130, please?
I make a motion, ask for a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Point is first reading. The ordinance number 61-5 through 61-11. The deputy clerk will read each ordinance. You will be able to come up and make any comments. There will be no questions, just comments. This for introduction.
Yes. 61-5, bond ordinance authorizing the resurfacing of various streets in the City of Linden and appropriating $2,530,000 therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $2,403,500 in bonds or notes to finance part of the cost.
Is there anyone wishing to make a comment? Can I have a motion, please?
I'd like to make a motion to introduce 61-5 and to get a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Mr. Deputy Clerk, can you please read 61-6?
Bond ordinance amending bond ordinance number 57-45, finally adopted on August 20th, 2013. This is changing the appropriation to $1,446,000 from $1,046,000, deleting the reference to $600,000 expected to be received from the NJDOT Federal Transportation Enhancement in connection with the improvement described in Section 3A1 of the bond ordinance, and substituting in lieu of, therefore, $1 million.
Does anybody want to make a comment? May I have a motion for 61-6, please?
Yes, I'd like to make a motion to introduce number 61-6 and get a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Mr. Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Ms. Deputy Clerk, can you please read 61-7?
An ordinance to amend and supplement Chapter 7 Traffic, Section 7-33 Handicap Parking Regulations, 7-33.1A Handicap Parking on Street, add Academy Terrace, one space, for property located at 1125 DeWitt Terrace, and delete 413 Richford Terrace, one space.
Anybody has any questions or comments? May I please have a motion?
Yes, Mr. President, I'd like to make a motion to introduce Ordinance 61-7 and ask for a second, please.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Mr. Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Ms. Deputy Clerk, can you please read 61-8?
An ordinance to amend an ordinance entitled, an ordinance establishing a schedule of titles, salary ranges, and regulations for maintaining the classification and salary standardization plan of all employees of the City of Linden, adding Schedule 4 LL2.
Does anybody have any comments? May I have a motion, please?
Council President, I move for introduction of Ordinance 61-8 and request a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Mr. Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Mr. Deputy Clerk, can you please read 61-9?
Bond ordinance amending bond ordinance number 59-44, finally adopted on November 10, 2015. This is changing the appropriation to $687,500 from $605,000 and changing the down payment from $30,250 to $34,375 and changing Section 20 costs from $60,500 to $68,000.
Does anybody have any comments? May I have a motion, please?
Yes, Council President, I'll make a motion for the introduction of Ordinance 61-9 and ask for a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Ms. Deputy Clerk, can you please read 61-10?
Bond ordinance providing an appropriation of $500,000 for the closure of Linden Sanitary Landfill for and by the City of Linden and authorizing the issuance of $475,000 in bonds or notes for financing part of the appropriation.
Does anybody have any comments? May I have a motion, please?
I move that Ordinance 6110 be introduced and request a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Ms. Deputy Clerk, can you please read 61-11?
Bond ordinance authorizing brook, storm, and sanitary improvements and removal of underground storage tanks at various locations citywide in and for the City of Linden. Appropriating $1,045,000, therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $992,750 in bonds or notes for financing part of the cost.
Does anybody have any comments? Can I have a motion for introduction, please?
Yes, Mr. President. I'd like to make a motion to introduce number 6111 and get a second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Mr. Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Nobody wants to talk today? Okay. Anybody up here wants to say anything? Out there.
I want to sing.
You have something? You forgot something? All right, Mr. Brooks. Well, now let's close the. I need a motion to close the public comment.
I make a motion.
Second.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond?
Yes.
Javik?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Brooks?
Yes.
Sadowski?
Yes.
Strano?
Yes.
Yamakaitis?
Yes.
Medina?
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Yes. Councilman Brooks, you want to make a comment? One minute?
Quickly. Lisa. Thank you, Council President. My prayers go out to the Hudak family as well. Also, March the 8th at the Linden Multipurpose Center, March 8th, Linden Multipurpose Center, I will be having a community meeting from 6 to 8. Linden Multipurpose Center, 6 to 8, March the 8th, community meeting for the 4th Ward. Looking forward to people being there. Enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Councilwoman Norman?
Yes, thank you, Council President. I just wanted to make the people of the City of Linden aware that approximately 6 o'clock p.m., the Linden Police Department responded to the 1100 block of West St. George Avenue on a reported suspicious package. The officers located the package, immediately began to clear the area in accordance with standard operating procedures. This included the closing of West St. George Avenue between North Style Street and Ross Street and the evacuation of residents of two of the apartment buildings. The Union County Bomb Squad is on the scene along with the Linden Police Department, and we're just asking that residents stay clear of the area until further notice. And also I'd like to congratulate the firemen who were promoted. They are men of great valor and reputation, and I'm just pleased that we have promoted some of Linden's finest. Thank you.
Councilwoman, so they haven't found anything yet?
No, I've been monitoring it. I don't have any of the further updates.
Thank you.
But it is borderlining the 10th and 1st Ward.
Thank you. Councilwoman Yamakaitis?
Yes, on a happier note, I just want to send out birthday wishes to Mr. Henry Mack, Henry Redding. It's his birthday tonight, and usually he's here to close a lot of our meetings, and I know many of our people that come to the council meetings and our viewers, you know, really appreciate some of his wisdom, okay? So happy birthday, Mr. Mack.
I think that was a little bit wrong what Ms. Yamakaitis wanted to say. It's the peoples would like to wish Mr. Mack a happy birthday from the peoples. Okay. The following council meetings will be as follows. The organization meeting on Tuesday council will be, council conference meeting, Monday, March 20, 2017 at 6 p.m. in the council conference room, City Hall, 301 Northwood Avenue. Council conference meeting prior to the council meeting, Tuesday, March 21st, 2017 at 6 p.m. in the council conference room, City Hall, 301 Northwood Avenue. Council meeting Tuesday, March 21st, 2017 at 7 p.m. in the council chamber, City Hall, 301 Northwood Avenue. May I have a motion to adjourn?
Like so moved.
Second.
Mrs. Ormond.
Yes.
Javik.
Yes.
Brown. Brooks.
Yes.
Sadowski.
Yes.
Strano.
Yes.
Yamakaitis.
Yes.
Medina.
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez.
Yes. Everybody drive carefully. Have a good night. Stay away from St. George Avenue.